Deri Llewellyn-Davies is one of those people who's done so much in life, it's impossible for me to summarize his accomplishments. He's achieved a lot in business, as well as with extreme adventure sports and mountain climbing and endurance events. He's done a TED Talk, which you can find very easily on YouTube, and he's also been on London Real. And he's now offering a new coaching package called Diamond Life Design. And you can find out more about it by going to benlowrey.com/Diamond Life Design. All the information is there. And as well as that, our sponsor for this podcast is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off their CBD oil as well as free shipping. Just go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk and use the discount code BenLowreyPodcast at checkout. And I'm also involved with a property investing joint venture group in South Wales, which is run and coached by a mentor whose name is Alex Louise Thomas. And if you're interested in finding out more about that, you can go to financialfreedomfilms.com. And if you want to be a guest on this podcast, or if you know somebody that would make a great guest, you can direct them to benlowrey.com/podcastguest. And if you're interested in sponsoring the podcast, you can go to benlowrey.com/sponsorship. All right then, Deri, how are you doing today? Thanks for coming on the podcast.
Pleasure, my friend. It's good to speak.
Yeah, it is. Hey, what you been up to?
Well, in what context are we talking to you, Ben? Because me and you, we can chew the cud on business, on life, on handstands. It was the last time we were talking, if I remember correctly.
Oh, yeah. How's your handstands coming on?
They're really quite shit still, I'm afraid.
All right. So. I mean, that's one area of life where you make me feel like I've got some talent. So that's good. We can stick on that topic. But
and that's the one area of life you've got it on me, man. I tell you, yeah. And I'm poor of you. I just cannot. I'm doing the yoga stuff, and I'm just getting there. I'm like, oh, gee, I can't. I'm not that. I want to be Ben. I want to be Ben on that front, definitely.
Well, I tell you what, I've got a few friends. We're going to go to the gym together next Wednesday. I don't know what your schedule's like, but do you know Chris Gibbons? I can't remember.
I remember the name. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Nice guy. Nice. He's into all the personal development stuff. You might recognize him if you saw him. Anyway, we're going to go to the gym. Like, if you wanted to come and do handstands, you're welcome to.
It's going to be what I don't know what I'm going to be doing. They're not going to be called handstands. Something. I think we start on a forward roll, shall we?
Yeah, yeah. So what gets most of your focus at the moment? What are you focused on? What's the current project?
So I've got kind of there's three focuses for me, and I think this is plays into the business space. It'd be interesting to see what the conversation goes with us today. But, you know, I've been focused on business strategy, and it's still a big part of who I am. You know, I help the scale up business grow. Typically, we work between companies between 1 and 20 million. But up there, there's different problems, all right? And as a result of that, we've spun off the secondary project now, which is Diamond Life Design. And that's taken a lot of my focus at the moment. And let's just go there for a minute, because I think what I've discovered in business, and I think I can be straight with you, can't I, Ben? I think this is going to be a straight conversation.
Let's give it a go. I don't want to make any promises, but let's try.
Let's give it a good go. There's so much hype around this business space and build a business and be an entrepreneur and, you know, and millionaire and, you know, be a millionaire by next Tuesday stuff, right? And that, you know, that's not me. It never has been me, by the way. Hmm. But I think what people aren't talking about, and don't get me wrong, I'm all up for choosing your passion. I'm all for choosing the wealth path that's right for you, whatever that may be. But I think the delusion is, and I've seen it too many times now, that one day, somewhere in the future, if I'm a millionaire or whatever arbitrary figure we put it on it, then I'm going to be happy and I'm going to feel successful. I'm going to feel great. And sadly, it's not that way. I work with million pound business owners, multi-million pound business owners all the time, and they have bigger stresses. I'm working with a lot of exits in businesses, and so we actually do the whole dream, right? So you build a business, you build a successful business, and you actually exit that business off the back end, right? Literally done one just pre-Christmas, and these guys exited it at about 23 million. And now I'm actually sitting down with the ex-CEO and having a much deeper conversation because he's depressed.
Right.
So I think we've got to just pull back the layers of this business thing and understand that if you are building a business or building whatever you're doing, properties, whatever, to one day feel good or one day that I will be happy, or one day I will feel successful. I think that's the delusion and the myth that's been sold out there, Ben. And the big part of what we're doing with Diamond Life Design is an integration, is that I love business and I love life, right? And I love both in equal measure. And Diamond Life Design is really starting with the end in mind, which is feelings, which is what is it that we seek, truly seek, and what are we feeling now? And if there's a massive gap between those two things, if we think money is going to fill that gap, or a business or something's going to fill that void, I think we're looking in the wrong places.
I'm with you. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. So with the Diamond Life Designs, is that your new thing? I know you've been doing the business growing stuff for a long time. So like, what are you offering now with Diamond Life?
And it's come out of the business, and I still love business. And I will always, BGI strategy, that's now taking its own form. Ian Mitchell's now running that as CEO brilliantly. It's 95 consultants around the world now running our methodology, which was strategy on a page. And I still work in boardrooms, and I always will. I love business, Ben, and I'll always have a fascination for business, and I'll always keep my hand in advisory of boards, which I do. But what I've seen from that, and I talk about it, I've been talking about it for two decades, right, on the stage, which is purpose. Why build a business? So it's not just build a business, it's build the right business. Build a business of no regrets, as I call it, and build a business to be proud of, right? And part of that purpose element of business is find something that you're passionate about. Find something that you're bringing service and value to the world, which you can clearly articulate. Find a market to serve, otherwise there's no market, no money, which is hobby business. And ensure that the money's right, which is you've got to earn money out of a business. If a business isn't generating profit, there isn't a business there. It won't be there for very long, right? But the fifth element, which I've always talked about, is lifestyle, which is don't wreck your life as a result of your business. And I've talked about it, but it was never right to bring it into the boardrooms. It was never right to go deep because we had enough work to do with the strategy side of things. But actually, that's the stuff I keep seeing over and over and over again, which was you actually, the irony, right? So much failure in the business world. We know it's, if you were a gambling person, you wouldn't gamble on business because it's the odds are crazy against us, right? So if you're going to go into business, at least something that you love to do and something that's going to add value. But then the irony, and this is the killer piece of the business model, is if you actually get it right, right, and you actually scale it and build a multi six figure or multi seven figure business, and you love what you do, you're bringing service and value to the world doing it, you've got a massive market to serve, you're scaling up, and you're making good money doing it, the likelihood is you're killing yourself in the process, you're stressed out of your face because you haven't handled a number of things along the way, which makes the multi-million pound business incredibly stressful. You wreck your health and you ruin your relationships. Is that no one's talking about that bit? Right. And I've touched on it from the stage for many years, and anyone that's seen me have seen that's a consistent message. But it's like, okay, they get it and they go, yeah, I get it. And then they don't do anything about it. And so Diamond Life Design really is the new architecture, which is architecting. And I mean, the word architect is very important. It's architecting a whole life and whole being the proper word around multi-dimensions, right? Because if business is being siloed so massively in that people are being taught the hustle, and don't get me wrong, I like, you know, but hard work is important, but hustling and killing yourself in the process is not the answer. Losing your health is not the answer. Losing your relationships is not the answer. And we've got to balance this thing called life, because if we think one day we'll get one, right, I'll just sacrifice this now, I won't see my kids for the next 5 years, but then one day I will, it just doesn't work like that. And I've seen it over and over and over again, Ben. So and it's the way I've architected my life for a decade. And this is what Diamond Life Design came out of, that. It's just the way I've been doing it. And actually, a business partner saw it on my wall. Actually, you can see it behind me on the wall back there, for those who are watching. It's been on my wall for a decade, and it's how I've created my life for a decade. I just never planned to bring it to the world. But my business partner, Andrea Pennington, she said, "We got to bring that to the world."
So what is that? What is that you got on the wall there? I didn't quite understand.
So Diamond Life Design, it is literally a big diamond framework. It looks like a diamond. It's an A1, and what we are doing is we are architecting life from top to bottom.
Okay.
Now, business is one thread of it, right? Like Stephen Covey really started to nail this back in the day. He was talking about this in the 1980s and 90s, right? Which was, if you are totally focused on one role in life and that role disappears, you can plummet into depression. I saw this in 2008. Mm. You know, my identity was wrapped up in business and wealth in 2008. And when wealth was pulled away from us, and if your identity is wrapped around that, suddenly who are you? Mm. I was talking to Billy Schwer, a good friend of mine, world boxing champion. And Billy was there. He was a boxer, right? His identity was boxing. He spent all his time on boxing. And then suddenly, you know, his career ended. And he was like, well, who am I now? So if we've identified with just one area of life, and business owners, be warned, this is the thing. The entrepreneurs out there, the business owners out there, those people who are striving for the financial freedom through whatever vehicle that might be, that might be property, might be stocks and shares, might be business. You know, those are the three primary elements. We can do that in total focus and total isolation and wreck everything else around us, thinking one day when the money comes or one day when we are supposedly successful, we will then feel the feelings that we're meant to feel. Mm. And I've just seen over two decades, it's not true.
Yes.
show me one, right? And what I find is, and don't get me wrong, it's all for having the right amount of money for freedom or whatever that means to you. But if we are not doing the inside work along the way, if we're not addressing the most important things in life along the way, Ben, what's it for? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And when I'm seeing multi-million pound business owners who have sold out and exited and are truly free, depressed and crying because they've lost their identity, and this was the time of their lives where they were supposed to be celebrating, and they've spent 20 years of their life to get to the point where they finally thought they'd made it, to be totally depressed, to lose purpose, and have no, and just don't even know what their identity was because their entire identity was wrapped up in one vehicle.
That's a massive failure, ironically, isn't it?
Yeah. Absolutely. And this is why I'm just coming to talk a little bit more real around it. And this doesn't mean I love business, right? I'm passionate about business, but I think we are building businesses for the wrong reasons. And we're building businesses with the wrong delusions coming into them. And sometimes, you know, the end path is just not pretty. And don't do that. It's like, why would we do that? So we're just trying to come in and have a realer conversation around the life part of where business really fits, Ben.
Deri, now, I don't want you to name any names necessarily, but give me an example of someone who's got it, who got it really, really wrong, and somebody who got it really, really right, you know, in terms of describing their lifestyle and what was working and what wasn't working.
I think there's a couple of clients, the client I just described just then, right? He focused 18 years worth of effort of building an incredible business, by the way, to the point of exiting for a tune of about 22 million pre-Christmas. Okay. In anyone else's eyes, that man is a success, right? He built a very good business, by the way, a business to be proud of, no question. Saw through, done most of the things, you know, he did mergers along the way, acquisitions along the way. Incredible, right? So, you know, that's, in the eyes of everyone, success. Mm. And now he's sitting here with total loss of identity. Because who are you? Right? If you go, if we just ask, who am I? Right? That's the primary question. Who am I? Right? If who am I is I am a business owner, and that's all I am, and that is all you are. And then that business is suddenly, and it's like, I am a father, right? If I lost my children, then my identity has just been completely removed. Mm. So this fundamental question, if all of our self-identity and all of our self-worth is in our business, and then that suddenly isn't there, in this case, in a good way, because it was sold, right? Now, can that happen in a business failure? Yeah, absolutely. I saw this too much in 2008. Of course, three people I knew closely committed suicide in 2008. Mm. And I was, by the way, I was close to it myself. I looked down the ledge in Denali and nearly made a decision myself at that point.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Why? It's a big,
so this is it's actually my first book, Life's Great Adventure. I'm very open about this in that chapter on Denali. I, at that point in my life, and this is why I'm preaching it now, you know, 10 years on, it took me a while to be able to speak really openly about this, Ben. But in 2008, you know, I built up a multi-million pound property portfolio and had the businesses and everything else. And then we know what happened in 2008. The crash came. I'd actually sold out before the crash in property. Smart move. And then stepped back in really quite aggressively after the crash and was buying up land banks at discounted rates. And I thought I was a genius, right? And then we know what happened next. The banks collapsed. Mm. So at that point, it all coincided with me being, you know me as an adventurer as well, right? So I'd run across the desert. I'd done my 6 marathons across the desert, the Marathon de Sahara at that point. I'd already climbed 3 of the highest mountains in the world, and I was about to embark on Denali, which is the highest mountain in North America, in the deepest Alaska. And it was all happening around the same time. So I found myself on Denali, literally failed summit bid on that day as well. It's the first time I'd failed in adventure, because we just got shut down in a brutal storm. I was taking legal calls at 17,000 feet, and I knew that the businesses were collapsing, the banks were gone down at this point, and I was facing bankruptcy when I came home.
Right.
And at that point, I was done, and I literally had one boot off the mountain. I thought, one step and I'm done, because I'm worth more dead than alive because of my life insurance policies at that point. And I can tell, you know, I've been there, Ben. And now why? And I spent, you know, 10 years since that unraveling that why. And the why is, was I had attached my entire identity and my self-worth to my businesses and money. Mm. And if your self-worth is attached to money, and your self-worth is attached to your business, and you suddenly don't have one, you're done. Mm. Right.
Were you a father at that point?
I was just. My little girl was 18 months and my first child. And it's the only thing that brought me back, Ben. Mm. At that time, my ex-wife and I, at that point, she was my wife at that point. We were having, it wasn't quite right either. So that wasn't bringing me back. In fact, we'd argued before I'd gone, and it was around money. This money thing is a real tricky one. And, you know, I went through that for a reason, and I went through that to come back to be stronger and spend the next decade exploring what that meant, and also finding out who I am truly. And that's a different conversation, Ben, because if we're going to build businesses, build them for the right reasons, right? Build them for passion, build them for value, build them to do some good in the world, but build them in a way that you are not trapping your entire identity within it at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, really clear. So what changes did you make then from that point forward?
Big changes when I came back from that. That mountain changed me in a big way, as did Everest 4 years ago. But the changes were really putting my health came first. I put my health right back to the front end. And I have ever since. You know, I'm now, you know, 44, and I've never been healthier, never been more vibrant. This energy thing is super important. So the way I fuel, the way I hydrate, the way I, you know, all my nutrition is front and center. When I was smashing it in business, it always came last, right? Business, haven't got time to eat properly, haven't got time to do this, haven't got time to meditate. So all my priorities started to shift. And don't get me wrong, I've ebbed and flowed in 10 years, but I've been pretty consistent in the last 4. You know, health and energy comes first. My meditation and my connection with something bigger than us comes first. My children, absolutely, they're right up there, will always be there. My beautiful partner, you know, and the closest people to me, my friends, my family. It's putting this whole beautiful spectrum of life we've got. Oh, and by the way, I've got this thing called business. Mm. And it's important, and I love my business. I love it, but I am not. And it has its weeks where you go, you know, you have your crazy week when you go a bit nuts, but it's like, bring it back, center, spend time with the children now, connect again, spend time in nature, connect again. And that's what Diamond Life Design is about. It's that rebalance. It's that getting it right down to, and by the way, the beauty of it is It's getting it. We architect it from the right up in the big element, run to the 10-year plan, the 1-year plan, and we bring it all the way back through the quarter, the month, the week, and the day, because it's about the moment. It's about today. It's about living. It's not about a day that's going to happen in 5 years' time. It's not about when you become a millionaire. You won't even know the moment you become a millionaire. It'll fly past you. You won't even notice it. So it's not about one day. It's about now. It's about today. And that's what changed for me, Ben. It was becoming and recognizing the moment. It took me years to work, you know, work on that and trying to get back to the moment. It's not a quick architecture, right? But for me, I reprioritized everything in life, and also prepared that, you know, if I go all in business, then I'm prepared for the consequences, because that can mean the business is going to go down. And I have to be able to look that in the eye and go, okay, I'm prepared to face that at any point, but it doesn't change my identity and who I am.
I see. What year was it where things really turned around and you felt like things were going good again and you felt better than before? Like, what point was that?
To be honest with you, it hit pretty quickly. I came at peace with myself on the mountain, and I literally walked off the mountain and I was a different man. That mountain, it broke me, and that mountain changed me. Because, and I think this is, I looked death in the eye literally that day from a making a decision point of view, but I also looked, I fell on the mountain in a very dramatic place and managed to save myself with an ice axe arrest. But I was very close in that moment. So and I talked to a number of kind of second lifers where when you've really looked death in the eye properly, you come back with a little renewed sense of purpose. So I have a slight advantage that I do some crazy stuff and I've nearly died as a result of it, right? So I can honestly say that was a pretty profound and swift shift for me. But I needed to nearly die to do it. So I don't recommend that to people, by the way, watching the show. I would recommend a more steady meditation practice.
So in terms of redefining your identity in terms that are like bigger than just a business or just parenthood or just whatever, like, how do you do that? Is that a simple task?
No, it's not. And it evolves. This is why, you know, the Diamond Life Design program that we're creating, it's not a one-off hit. We've created a whole year-long program as part of it and an ongoing one from there. There's a year two already designed already, because this isn't, you don't go to a course in a day. Now, don't get me wrong, you go to like you remember Tony Robbins, you know, you've been to the Tony Robbins stuff. You go to a Tony Robbins UPW back in the day and you have a brilliant couple of days, right? And you will make shifts, no question, but it's not sustained shifts. So, and also this is a bigger question. You'll probably make one shift or two shifts in that day, but it's not all the shifts. So it's about architecture, right? It's about redesigning. This is why we call it Diamond Life Design. It's about redesigning the life that you want. But it's not like we do start on the vision and everything else, right, where you want to be one day, but it's about who you are today. That's what you got to get it back to, otherwise it just sits out there somewhere, right? And it's the designing it piece by piece, right? Part of life by part of life. And I reckon there's, for most people, there's about 6 to 8 areas. And then we've got to drill each of those in and understand the rhythm of each of those areas. And look, the core ones are obvious, right? The business or career sitting in there. Money, if you like it or not, is its own area, because it's got such a energy around it, money, for good and bad, by the way. And that's the one that really messes most people up. It's the biggest mess up of relationships and everything. So money typically, and most people are ignoring that one completely in their lives, by the way. Relationships are in there on multi-levels. That could be your, you know, your intimate relationship with your children, friendships, family. You've got health and vitality. I call it energy in there. You know, we've got, I've got travel and adventure is mine, right? Because I love travel and adventure is a big part of mine. But that to somebody might be music. It could be in a lot of different areas. My home, I love home and property. So it's about designing what are the big stuff, right? Well, let's put the big stuff in. It's like the Wheel of Life stuff, right? Back in the old days, right? So what's the big stuff? But then you've got to architect every single one of those pieces bit by bit right the way down. And I think identity, which is the question you asked, Ben, that's more around the roles we play. So we take every area of life and just go, what roles do we truly play? Because our identity is in our roles.
How do you mean? What do you mean roles?
So it's father is a role, okay. Right? CEO is a role. I'm a business leader. I'm a mentor. Some days I'm mentoring. Some days I am consulting. Sometimes I'm coaching, right? You're a brother, a father, a son. So all these different roles we play. I'm also a creator, an artist, a gardener. I'm an adventurer, a global citizen. So it's understanding, because our whole identity is the role we play in life, right? Now, if therefore our whole, who are you? I'm a CEO of a business. That's it. That's what I am, right? Mm. That's your identity. For me, I have so many roles I play in life, which are important to me.
So
and
is
it's
each,
that blend.
So is each role like an individual leg to the table? So that is it good to have many roles? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, well, the danger, the opposite side of the spectrum, which is Stephen Covey was alluding to in when he was talking the Seven Habits, which I still think is one of the greatest books of time. Mm-hmm. He was alluding back then, right, saying if you just got one identity, one role in life, then and that is removed from your life, you're done, right? So he was talking about then the balance. This is where I first came across the concept of the roles. I didn't fully integrate it at that point in my life. It took me until 10 years ago before I really got that, right? I've probably got quite a few roles, but that's because I've evolved through the architecture more. Mm. But I think if you look at it, and this is when you go, where's the missing gap? What do you want to architect? Mm. You recognize, and I think this is where I'm bringing this into the business space particularly, right? This isn't mass personal development market for me.
I was just going to ask you that. Who is this aimed at?
Absolutely not. Most people will not want to do the work, right? Mm. Because this is work. You've already recognized it, Ben. This isn't a quick hit. This is about evolution and evolving across all areas of life consistently at all levels and exploring and constantly redefining who you are and what's important to you, which takes time and effort. And the ones that will resonate the most with this, because it's slightly complex as well, right? Mm. If you just want an easy life, then good luck with that, because for me, I would never be able to achieve what I've done and have the balance I had if I hadn't consciously architected it, right? Mm, mm. So this is for the business owners. This is for the entrepreneurs. This is for the people who are trying to get success in that level, because there's a complexity with that success. And there's that's where identity gets lost in that success. So it's like, no, you can have it all, actually. And it's not in a you can have it all by next Tuesday way. Mm. It is but what does having it all mean? And ironically, the more complex I get, right, the more I evolve, which is a continuous process till the day we die, the more simple it gets, right? And for me, and I know every day, as long as water's critical, right? As long as I drink loads of water, that I take the right nutrition in and eat properly with my supplementation, I connect with my children, I connect with my love, right? I spend some time in meditation to reconnect to the source above. I spend some time in exercise, whatever that may be. If that's, I love strength yoga. Still can't do a handstand though. I love my running and my distance, and I connect with nature, and I do creative work. If I just do all those simple things, none of that takes a long time, by the way. As long as I do the basics every single day, it's a beautiful day and I feel great.
Mm.
If I just smash, wake up in the morning, and it happens every now and again, don't get me wrong, I'll be traveling or something, you wake up, you're on the mobile phone, poof, you're off, and then you just pile through a crazy 17-hour day, and you hit the pillow at the end of the day, and you go, what was that all about? That's not a good day.
Mm. Do you literally schedule the day? I mean, do you have your segments scheduled?
Absolutely. And this is the thing, I design it right back to the day. Hour by hour, but it's not like at 7:15 we must do this. It's the blocks. Mm-hmm. It's just and there's an interesting rhythm to those blocks, but it's not my rhythm. It's not your rhythm, right? And I think this is where a lot of the time management programs and stuff have failed. And this is why I don't agree so much with the morning ritual stuff,
right?
in that I love a morning ritual. I have one, but most of the morning ritual stuff is like, you should wake up and then you should do this and you should read and you should meditate 50 minutes and you should exercise 20 minutes and you do this, right? Mm. Which is wonderful for them, right? Mm. And I say, what's important in your life, right? Let's architect the whole of life and find out what's important first. And let's re-engineer back into the day and the morning to what matters to you. Because if actually an exercise for me, a lot of people, everyone insists that in the morning ritual you should do exercise, right, and get the body moving. I like to do a little bit of qigong in the morning, a few minutes, but that's it, because I get my exercise later in the day and that suits my energy better.
Mm. Yeah, same, right? Here, yeah.
Yeah, so it's like, and this is what I mean, so many of these is do this, and they prescribe it. Mm. Because it's worked for them, which I get, and I don't dispute that. I'm like, great, good job, you know, well done. That's a nice morning ritual for you, mm. right? And I think so many people are just spoon-fed these days. It's just like, just do this, and you will be happy. Well, no, actually, sorry, you've got a bit more work to do first. Your work is to work out what's the true integration of the pieces you want, who you are. You've got to ask yourself the difficult questions of who am I? And then we must architect around that, write down. And if that morning ritual involves spending 10 minutes with your rabbit, because you love rabbits, I don't know where that came from, by the way, I'm not a rabbit person, but then that's your ritual, mm. right?
Yeah.
So you go, it's got to just be consciously architected. That's the trick with all of this, Ben.
I see.
And it's this integration. Now, you know this from your body movements and the way you've created mastery with your body, with what you've done. And I watch you with what you can do from a gymnastic perspective. And that is, that's almost, I don't know, you tell me, because it looks like that's spiritual to me.
Well, I know what you mean. And I do have my rituals as well. Like every, and they're rituals that I enjoy and they like. They're not like something I feel a duty towards. Like, for example, I mean, like you said about the gym and exercise, I usually like to go like late morning around about 11 o'clock. I like to do in the morning, I like to get myself into a good state, but not in terms of, not necessarily a Tony Robbins routine. I like to watch videos of successful people. I love watching, boxers and like UFC and like, or business inspiration or Grant Cardone or that kind of stuff first thing in the morning. Cause I find that gets my juices flowing. That gets my mind switched on and, you know, fired up. And so that, and then I might do a bit of admin and emails and just doing a bit of that kind of thing. And then I go to the gym late morning. I'll do 2 hours of handstand practice sometimes and then weights, and yeah, that's very consistent, you know, that's kind of my daily thing sort of most days.
And you see, and that's you, that's your yeah. That's your uniqueness, right, coming through there. Mm. Some of that ritual, like, that's not my bag. It's like 2 hours of handstands, I can do 2 minutes of falling over, right? But it's that. And I this is the whole point of Dime Life Design, is this non-prescribed delving into finding out who we truly are, and that there's no shortcuts to this journey, right? It's only you can find out who you are. And I think where it works really well is someone sees somebody else's morning ritual and go, I'll have that, please. And it works because that person is incredibly like them. That's when it will work well. Mm. But most people won't be like that. And you've got to, it's your duty to find out what's true to you. What makes you tick, what's important to you. And then, and it's the, and you nailed it just then. It's the, if it feels like a duty, then you probably got the wrong thing.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I completely agree. I feel quite passionate about that, as you can probably tell. Like, that really kind of grinds my gears when people talk about like meditating. There's nothing wrong with meditating, but sometimes I get the sense from people like it's an effort, like it's a discipline thing, like they don't really want to do it, but they feel like they should. A lot of people have that vibe with it, you know what I mean?
And this, now, my biggest battle of all, I think, next to money, by the way, is the meditation piece. I've been struggling with that for 20 years. I really have, because 20 years ago, it was like, do meditation. I was like, why? Right? Mm. I'm really busy. First thing to go. So, because again, I was prescribed, just do this, you know, sit. And I was back in the day. Meditation has evolved massively in the last 2 decades, right? And I think it's a lot better understood. And your apps, and it's made it cool, and it's made it a lot more accessible. But back then it was sit in lotus position, go like that, and say om, and it just didn't work for me, right? Mm-hmm. Since then, I've explored 40, 50 different versions and styles and things of meditation. And I've just found along the way what resonates with me. I love walking meditation. Out in nature is one of my favorites, to connect with nature at the same time. But it's that, this word meditation or mindfulness, it's very misunderstood. And I think people, and again, it's back to, it's not just prescribed. It's like, just do this. No, well, you've got to explore. What do you want? Mm-hmm. What is it you want to feel from meditation? What are you seeking from meditation? Why are you doing it in the first place?
Yeah.
And if you're just doing it because that bloke told you to do it, that's probably not going to fit. And you're probably sitting there like a plum for 20 minutes, yeah, not really getting much done, right? So it's this, it's back to, I think, taking in self-responsibility. I think the personal development world, although I'm a massive fan of it and a product of it as well in many instances, it's become really prescribed. It's become, you know, just do this. And people just want to follow almost blindly in certain cases, like sheep. As a Welshman, I can say sheep, right? and it's not racist, right? This is why this message is really to the entrepreneurs and the business owners out there who won't follow blindly. They need a bigger reason to do what they want to do. And I'm like, yes. And this is the work. The work is to go deep, and the work is to understand who am I, and be able to then architect a life around what's truly important to you. And that is different for every one of us. And that's the beauty, right? The beauty is the difference. Mm. You know, for me, one of the elements is adventure. You know, I do these crazy adventures around the world. That's my soul calling there, right? Mm. To get to the mastery level you've got with the gymnastic ability, that's called you in a way that's undescribable. Now, I found that, and you found that in those ways, right? My message to everyone out there is, if you haven't found that somewhere, whether that's in music or art or whatever that thing is, right, that's part of the juice. And without that, if you haven't got some magic woven into this architecture, which is called life, and you just think smashing it in work constantly day after day after day, because one day you're going to find that magic somewhere, that's not what I believe.
Hey, who's been your most significant teachers that you've learned from?
Oof, geez, loads. I've been part of this, the professional and personal development world for 2 decades. That's what we met, like, probably 15, 18 years ago, Ben?
I reckon about 15, because it was when I started going to Yes Group about 2005, yeah.
Yeah, geez. So I've been involved, you know, Tony Robbins definitely had a strong influence in the early days. I did the whole mastery with Tony early. So Tony's been influenced. Brendan Burchard's been a more recent influence. I was in his center ring a number of years ago. I love Brendan, and I love what he stands for, and certainly with the way he's gone with the high performance work as well. Bo Eason is another mentor of mine from America in the speaking world. And in business world, I've had multiple mentors along the way, many actually. One which is a slightly controversial mentor is Dan Pena.
I was going to ask you.
Yeah, so I spent, you know, I was on the Castle Experience with Dan early. I was back in 2004, I think, or 2000. It was in the mid-2000s, I was with Dan, so a long time ago before Dan's very popularized now. Mm. But I was back in, did his Castle Experience many years ago, and Dan taught me how to raise money. There's no question his influence on that. And since then, a big part of what I do in business is raise capital. So I've raised millions of pounds across multiple businesses for many, many years. And I attribute a big part of that to Dan, no question. So, and I continue, you know, mentors have always been a big part of my life, Ben, and they always will be. I now get to mentor lots of people, which I'm very honored to be able to do. But equally, I will constantly seek mentors myself. And I think that's a big misnomer, I think, in this space. I was on the stage. It's the Association of Business Mentors nationally, right? Run by Kerry Dorman. And this is the kind of accredited, if you want to call it that, really the top mentors in the UK. You have to go through a certain accreditation. They've all been vetted to a level of standard. She's all about high standards in the mentoring world. And I was on the stage for Kerry last year, and the questions came in is who mentors you. Now, I won't mention any names, but there was a very, very high profile mentor on that stage. And when asked this question, they said, no, I've never had a mentor and I don't really feel the need. Mm-hmm. And they are a high level mentor to others. I nearly fell off my chair at that point. I really did. And I think a lot of coaches, a lot of consultants, a lot of mentors, and there'll be a number listening to this, I'm sure, you get to a certain level and now you don't think you need a coach or you don't think you need a mentor. And well, I'll tell you something, the best coaches in the world and the most accredited coaches in the world, it's certainly in the standards bodies, they have to have a coach. It's the rules. So a coach without a coach, I think, is a dangerous weapon. A mentor without a mentor, that's a lone wolf. So that question is incredibly important, Ben. And I think what I encourage, you know, mentors have been a big part of my success for my entire career and life, and they continue to be so. And by the way, in all areas, I'm talking about business a bit more there, but the works of Esther Perel and Harville Henricks in Parts of Love, relationships. There's mentors in relationships out there who are amazing. Big fan of the Dave Asprey stuff and Bulletproof. I've been I was an ambassador for Bulletproof a number of years ago, and I massively rate Dave Asprey's work. But see, there's mentors across all of life. Mm. You just got to decide what's important to you in life, and then seek out mentors in that space.
So if someone's listening to this and they're thinking, right, I want to sign me up, man. I want your coaching, your mentorship. I want to be involved. Where do I begin? Where do they start with you?
This is really half the press now. We're only just starting to bring it to the market, and it's a bit covert, to be honest. We'll get you a link out, Ben. But this isn't, I don't personally coach anymore. We've created a full online experience, which is easy to come into. There's a whole masterclass before you come in. So we'll send you the links, go and have a check out, and also check out my partner, Andrea. She's amazing. Dr. Andrea Pennington, a media celebrity from America. She's in the health and nutrition side, amazing. Celebrity. She's been on Oprah Winfrey twice. She's just an incredible Buddhist in her beliefs. So she's an incredibly balanced individual. So you're getting two views. This isn't the Deri show. This is actually two views, and we're bringing in our best friends alongside us. But it's just come at diamondlifedesign.com. We'll send you the link, Ben. But then don't come in lightly, right? This isn't the pitch, right? We're there to really truly help architect and re-architect life, which takes work. We want to work with the people who really want to step up and make a difference, because we're creating a quite a beautiful and niche community under the banner of that.
That's great, Deri. So I'll display the link so people can click that and they can go and find out more about that. And have we got time to talk about your mountain adventures and stuff? I know that's a whole speech and a whole story in itself, but I mean, I don't know.
What do you want to know, Ben? Anything for you?
I mean, you've done some crazy shit, haven't you?
That is official, yes. I think that's what you describe it as.
Oh, by the way, you did a TED talk some years ago, which I watched. Mm. And maybe it's best to refer people to that, because you tell the whole story there, don't you, very nicely.
Yeah, well, interestingly, it's being relaunched. There's a video. Watch out on my site, because Deri.live's going live like now. And in there, there's a video referring to the TED Talk, because that TED Talk was a disaster for me.
Was it?
Yeah, and not many people know that. And I've let it go for years now, but it's had 300,000 views now. And it seems to be amplifying at the moment.
Why is it a disaster?
Because no one notices it. I tried to get that TED pulled. I didn't want it to go public.
Why?
Because it was one of my worst speeches. I know. And this is now, if you go back and watch the first 3 minutes, you'll understand why. I've just done a 5-minute blog explaining. And there was a bit of ego in that for me as well. Because I was, that was the big TEDx in the UK. It was the Edinburgh. So the entire Edinburgh Hall, I was the closing keynote. So it was an important speech. And if you watch, right, in the first 2 minutes, I have got a head mic on.
Yeah.
And then in minute number three, I suddenly don't have a head mic. I've got a hand mic. No one notices it.
I didn't notice.
That's, the whole thing's edited out brilliantly. But the in the first, like, anyone as a speaker on the stage, imagine you're in the main theatre in Edinburgh, like thousands of people there. The first 2 minutes went to rats. The entire auditorium started echoing and the mic was booming and the mic blew up in my back pocket.
Oh, really?
About one minute 50 in, the mic blew up.
Oh.
And the entire Edinburgh thing had to shut down. They had to then come in and change my mics out, go to hand mic. It was a disaster. And then I just had to carry on.
All right.
So for me, that's not me at my best, right?
Okay. Now,
clearly. But what is amazing when you launch it back is, and this comes back to preparation, right? I've done about 10,000 hours on the stage now, is that what I am proud of is the fact that that could be edited out and no one noticed. 300,000 people have not noticed that.
I didn't notice.
And that's because I was ready and prepared for that.
Right.
Now, sadly, I was not at my best because clearly it's an emotive journey that you're being taken on there. And those first 3 minutes is really important to the emotion part of it, which I didn't manage to nail in that one. But there's a whole thing around identity there. And I didn't want it. Sometimes you have to get out of your own way in perfectionism. That was the blog I've just written around it, is that I just needed to let that go to the world. Because sometimes what we think, right? Because I'm like, that's not me at my best. You know, 300,000 people think something different. So a lot of the times we have to get out of our own perfectionism.
I mean, I was just going to say, for what my opinion's worth, don't worry about it. I thought it was great. I didn't even notice.
And that's the thing, isn't it? So, but yeah, that tells the story of Everest. Or one, you know, a part of the story of Everest.
Clearly. I'll put a link to it. Also, something I wanted to ask you, are you a listener? Are you an audiobook podcast guy, or do you sit and read?
Bit of both, actually. I love reading. So I'm still an avid reader. I still smash about a book or so a week. I've got libraries around my house. So readings are, and I like, for me, reading's relaxation, right?
I see.
But I also, I like to do double time. So for me, it's double and triple time where if I'm out for a run, I'll be listening or making phone calls or just connected with nature. If I'm in the car, I'll be listening. So it's I use journeys and stuff. I wouldn't just sit and just listen to something. It's only if I'm in the car and I can't do other stuff with my hands.
Mm.
But I love audiobooks. I love reading and I love podcasts.
How do you combine, is your wife involved, or your partner rather, involved with your business activities, or does she do her own thing? Like, how do you manage that?
Very carefully. So my ex-wife was never part, my ex-wife's a doctor, so that was never part of it. My new lovely partner is soon to be wife, by the way, that's hot off the press.
Oh.
She is in business, but no, we're not in business together. We may well be in the future, I think, but I manage that very carefully. I've worked with quite a few partner businesses, or husband and wife businesses, and it's quite beautifully elegant when you get it right. It's quite destructive if you get it wrong.
I see.
So, and a family business is the same, especially when you start to go multi-gen. I work with a lot of multi-gen family businesses. There's a dynamic there, which is slightly unspoken. So we like to keep, you know, we are very supportive and involved in each other's businesses because she's amazing in the digital media world. But we say separate at the moment. We are coming together on one project coming up in the future, which is Limitless to You. Well, you'll start to see that expand now. It's the third strain to what I do, which is going a lot more into the high performance space, but unraveling that. Diamond Life Design is very clearly architecture. It's about architecting it. Whereas Limitless You is more about how do you really gain this limitless energy? And it's multifaceted again through nutrition and hydration. And we've got some of the best coaches in the world behind us for that as well.
Right. And also, I'm curious, you said you've got to finish at some point because you're picking up your kids. And I'm just interested how, like, I'd imagine if you wanted to be just working 16 hours a day, you could be, you know, and somebody else could be picking up the kids. But clearly you've chosen to do that. And, like, could you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you nailed it there, right? We can all be working 16 hours a day, can't we? Especially if we've wrapped up our identities in one thing. Now, for me, the hardest bit about the divorce, you know, I was with my my ex-wife for about 17 years, and it was a mutual divorce because it was like we just drifted, we just weren't wanting the same things in life anymore. So it wasn't a massive storm, but we had these three beautiful girls. That was the hard bit, right? The decision was really clear for me at that point. And no matter what happens, I want the children half of the time. That's the only fair and reasonable thing. And that half of the time, I'm a dad. That's what my identity in that half of the time is. I'm a father for that half of the time fully, right? And I sat down, and my ex is still doing shift, so a number of the times she is using the nanny and having to do it. But my kids, I constantly spend special time with my kids, which is, you know, every day, every week, we carve out special time for, you know, for each of my children individually. By the way, I think it's important when you've got multiple children that you have that individual time. For me, is critical. No matter what, do you know what they say? Every day they ask the same question: "Daddy, are you taking us into school today? And Daddy, are you picking us up?" Because the nanny could do it, and I could get an extra couple of hours out of the day, right? Yeah. But the most important thing to my kids, bar none, is that they want me to drop them at the gates and they want to see me when they come home, right? And I don't, parents listening to this, you know, it's a choice, and some of you don't have that luxury, and because if you're in a job, this whoever invented schooling systems and holidays and the rest of it clearly didn't do it for people with a job, right? Mm. 6 weeks off in the summer, that was a nightmare for parents with a job. But I run my own businesses, and that's big part of the reason I do it, was for flexibility, so I can be there. And by the way, I'm one of the only dads at the school gates.
That's one of the greatest things that comes out of that lifestyle of being self-employed, isn't it? Is the freedom and the flexibility to be there for your own kids, isn't it?
Well, you think. That's the point of it, isn't it? For me, that is one of the most important things of it. And yet, most of us, we end up getting crazy, working crazy hours and not doing the very things we should. And, you know, no matter what, I want to be there for the main events. Like, I've got a massive speaking gig that I could have been doing next Monday. And they said, "Will you come and do this?" And it was for a global player, big gig. And I went, "Really sorry, I can't do that date. It's sports day." So, it's for me, it's not a decision anymore. It's like, and that's about as big as gigs get, right? And I was looking at it, and is there another way of doing it? And it's like, no. And actually, for my eldest, it's her last year in primary school. She goes to secondary school next year. And it's her last sports day. Mm. My kids are a little bit competitive, so they're clearly going to smash the other kids in the school. I want to see them win. So,
right. So because you've got clarity about your life, because you've architected it and designed it that way and written it down, yeah, it's like you just said, it's not a decision for you. I mean, like that speech could have, who knows, it could have been worth a lot of money financially, but because you're clear on your priorities, your values and all the rest of it, it's just that it's not a decision. You just...
It's not now. No, don't get me wrong. Go back, you know, 5 or 6 years, that would have been a way harder decision and I may have swung another way. But for me now, it's very clear. I'll never get that sports day back.
Yeah,
I'll never see my eldest run that race again in her never again. Right, she'll be in secondary school next year. Mm. So, but there'll be another speaking gig. And this is it. Business is so important, and meetings are so important, and we can't, you know, must do it all. No, actually, you've got a choice, and I just the biggest thing I think, I've got a blog post coming out on this soon, is the biggest shift in the mindset from the six-figure to the seven-figure business, from the startup mindset to the scale-up mindset, if you're going to be successful, and this includes life as well, right, is from learning to say yes to learning to say no.
Right.
In the early days, you say yes to everything, right? Generally in life, but in business, it's like, yes, yeah, I'll do that. Yes, I'll do that. And you know, as you start a business, you'll just take any business. You'll take any client. You know, it's yes. But then if you keep doing that forever, and this is where a lot of businesses fail at the million-pound level mark, right, is because if you keep doing that, it's not scalable.
Yeah,
it's just not. It's massively destructive. It's very inefficient. So you've got to learn to say no very quickly. And it's the same in life, is that if you say yes to everything, I know there's a couple of philosophies out there, Well, just say yes to everything. I'm open to that. I'm open to most things, right? But equally, you've got to learn how to say no to things that aren't important. Now, the only way you can learn to say no to things that aren't truly important is by knowing what's truly important.
Right.
If you don't do that work, and you haven't got that, but also you've got to embed that work deeply, and that's through meditation and practice and everything else. If you don't know that, then you're going to be in conflict all the time. So it's like you waste so much energy burning, going, oh, I shouldn't. It's like, no, that's what's important in life. And that's my choice, right? So it's like drinking. I haven't drunk alcohol much for about 10 years, to be honest. I've had a little dabble here and there, but I haven't drunk alcohol for about 2 years now. I could. People say, are you teetotal? No, I just don't drink. I will again at some point when I fancy it, but I just haven't chosen it because I know the impact it'll have on me and it doesn't serve my priorities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and it's not a choice. My current partner, bless her, when she... my partner for life, I should say. Jeez. So my partner, when she found out I didn't drink, there was a real weird few months at the front of it. She's like, you all right? Is this something like were you an alcoholic or something? I was like, no, I'm good. And it's funny, I'm in society and, you know, going out with her friends and going out in London and everything else. I'm the weirdo.
Right.
I'm the anomaly because I don't drink.
Yeah.
Isn't that an interesting society we live in where just because I don't drink, it's kind of, are you all right?
Yeah. Hey, how do you find it? How are you like, hey, Deri, I know you're limited on time, but I just want to...
I'm good for another 50 minutes, but then it is school run, I'm afraid.
Okay, yeah.
I'm here with you, my friend.
How do you deal with, like, are you quite fussy about who you keep as in your close friends' inner circle? And how do you deal... Like, what? Let me just try and decide what I'm asking you. How do you discern? How do you deal with dickheads?
Yeah, that's a really. I was going to cut through it, Ben. Like, that's. I don't let them anywhere near me. There's. Have you ever come across Joe Simpson?
No.
Joe's a good dear friend of mine. We were in a mastermind for many years together. She's does values work. Right. Now, she does this exercise, which is a closed eyes exercise, where you go in and you envision your land. Right. So you just it's a deep meditation and you just envisage your land and it's your land. You can create it as you want it to be. And mine had mountains and trees and beautiful things and all this kind of stuff. Right. And then she said, have a look at the boundaries of your land. Right. And bear in mind, you're in a meditation. So you're creating this in your mind and it's your stuff. Right. My boundaries were like massive blockades with wire at the top and a tank. There's no one coming into my fucking land, basically, right? I didn't know the context of this. Only afterwards, when we were going through it, Jo was laughing at me. She's like, wow, I've never seen anyone with such strong boundaries, right?
Right.
Now, I hadn't realized what I'd been doing, but I learned a long time ago, I will not let assholes into my space.
Right.
I just won't tolerate them. I don't want them anywhere near my energy. But by the way, this was part of the architecture of life, is I know what I stand for, I know who I am, and I know who I want in my space. And then those who are in my space, I'll give them all. You've got my full heart. But those who aren't, not interested. And I think that's one of the most important decisions you can make around boundaries. Now, equally, other people in that room, Ben, when it came to boundaries, there were none.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone could just come bundling into their land, right? Just raid in at any point. And I think that's such an important part because life's too short. I want to have maximum energy. And I can tell you, put the wrong person into your life, whoof, out goes that energy. You know what I'm talking about, that you feel it. You can feel energy just draining out of you. So just don't let them anywhere near you. And if you consciously architect properly, then you've got to be consciously architecting who. There's a whole part of my diamond, which is family and friends, right? And I got, I'm very clear who my closest people are, but I've got a network, I've been around for years, so I've got a good network. And I've known you for years. I've known your dad for years. I'll have a coffee with you guys anytime. You know that, right? Like we had the other month, right?
Mm.
But there's a lot of people in this world don't come near me. I'd do it politely, but again, I'm not interested. Don't come in my world. We've got to, and I think as humans, you've got to know what you stand for and what you don't stand for, and we should not tolerate that. And sadly, a lot of that is those closest to us. That can be family.
That's really good to hear, actually, because I think this is one of the lessons I've had to learn over the last 6 months. I had too many idiots in my life, and like you said, it's a drain of energy. And also, there's a lot of people that preach kind of boundaryless compassion and love everyone and forgive everyone, and it doesn't really work, does it? In order to be effective, you've got to have standards and boundaries and rules, and you know, for what you'll tolerate and what you won't, etc.
I look, if there is forgiveness, 100%, right? Mm. I think the closer I get to spirit, the closer I understand God, whatever you want to call, whatever your belief is, right? I truly believe we are all one. I truly believe we are connected to one source. I believe when we get back to the divine, we're all there in one big pool, whatever that may be, whatever God that may be. This life is here to be explored and to be experienced in its greatest. So therefore, do I hold animosity to the dickheads? No, I pity them and I forgive. And I think forgiveness is fine. There's forgiveness, and now stay outside my circle, right?
Yeah.
So it's not like, oh, I forgive you, now just pile all over me again and destroy. That's not, if they've got their stuff, I honor that. Now just stay away from me, right? So I don't need to have, because if you're like, you're a dickhead and you're over there and you're still mad and angry with the dickhead, then you haven't done your work. But forgiveness does not mean they may trample all over you and just continually come and siphon off your energy. That's not what I believe in. So I think we mix up a lot of these messages, or we take some of these messages too literally. And again, comes back to some of this preaching out there is a bit too prescribed, isn't it?
Mm.
And I think this is where we have to do our own work to understand what's truly important to us.
Yeah, got it. Also, something else I've had to learn to accept is like to accept the stuff you can't control and have no influence on in the world, because it can drive you insane. Like if you're trying to fix the world and make the world as you want it, like it's an impossible task, isn't it? And there's a madness in that, but there's a kind of, I think there's something wise of being able to differentiate between the stuff you do have influence over and the stuff you don't, and accept that difference.
Oh, 100%. And I think, Brexit at the moment, we hear that word over here is just noise now, right? Mm-hmm. Yes. Is it going to have impact on this? Yes. Can any of us individuals control it? Absolutely not. Let's just get on with it. Let's get on with life, right? So, and it's that, and it comes back to when you architect your life, you've got to architect what you want to do under your control, not a load of random, you know, randomness in there, which you've got no control over. Mm-hmm. One day I'd like to do whatever, and you've got no control over it. It's that we can control our breath. We control what we put in our bodies. We can control our energy. There's so much stuff we can control, which is beautiful and divine and close to us. And yet we're trying to manipulate everything else around us at the same time. I 100% agree, Ben.
Cool. Well, I'll tell you what, Deri, I really appreciate your time today. I wonder if you would just leave us with any final thoughts, any final book recommendations or people to follow, and any final call to action or anything you want to say.
I would say the last, I think my core message everywhere around the world has always been live a life of no regrets. And I think I will leave you on that one. If you go to Deri.live, there's a whole blog series just around, we did a whole global study around regret and what the six core regrets in life are. That'll kick you into shape a little bit. So, and it's that a lot of people are goal setting or want to achieve something. I look through different lenses. Would I regret this if I was going to die tomorrow by not doing it? And it's a very different lens to look through, Ben. So, and it's a more powerful lens, because then if you're going to regret it if you die tomorrow, it's a way more powerful than one day I'd like to maybe do something. Mm. And I think goal setting has been overrated and put out of context over the decades. So live a life of no regrets is my big message.
Awesome, Deri. I really appreciate it. It's been great talking to you, and I hope to catch up with you again soon.
Always a pleasure, Ben.
All right. Okay, bye for now.
Cheers, mate.
All right,
take
bye.
Care.